try to shake off the rather restrictive form of the religious authority in the Renaissance, for example, then Aristotle got blamed for the bad bits of this authoritarian dogma and came to be seen as an enemy of scientific advance. That was, of course, quite unfair, because it wasn't Aristotle who was opposing it, but the religion which had been yoked with Aristotle.
With the coming of Christianity, philosophy took second place to theology. It tended to look backwards, to the golden age of Plato.
Plato, in a way, was the most important person for philosophy and theology in the ancient world. He was known as the philosopher, and Christians, although they were initially reluctant to engage with philosophy, found that they had to, partly because they were under intellectual attack from philosophers, and partly just because they were interested in making converts and apologetics. And to do that, particularly if you're interested in converting or conversing with intelligent people, involves dealing with philosophy. And Plato, of course, was the main philosopher in the period. I think Christians found Plato quite appealing, because a lot of Plato's thought and the thought of his followers has something in common with Christianity. For example, Plato thinks that the world was created and that there was a creator God, obviously recognizable Christian beliefs as well. He believes that there's an immaterial soul, very sympathetic for Christians. Some of his followers, particularly Plotinus and Neoplatonists, think that there is a trinity of godlike or divine persons or entities, the top one being the One, from whom proceeds intellect, from whom proceeds soul. And Christians were quick to spot that this bears some resemblance to their doctrine of the Trinity. So it may just be that part of the reason why Plato was so appealing, apart from his overall pervasiveness, is that Christians found they could actually learn something from him. We certainly know from Augustine that part of his conversion to Christianity and the route that he went through involved reading the Platonists and learning from them, and from them seeing how Christianity was, as it were, the perfect form of really a pagan philosophy.
Augustine of Hippo lived from 354 to 430 AD and came from a Christian family. He accepted Plato's ideas on the forms, which he said were thoughts in the mind of God. All human knowledge was a product of illumination by God. Human happiness is being at one with God. Augustine believed God existed in eternity and created the world from nothing. Creation is an absolute. How then can there be change?
Augustine thinks that God himself is timeless and immutable, in line with normal Neoplatonic thought. And his view is that this timeless and immutable God creates the world of temporal and changing things, so that there's a very strong contrast between the two. Change itself is explained by Augustine in a somewhat unexpected way. Augustine thinks, again following certain Neoplatonists, particularly Plotinus, that, as it were, intrinsic in things is a kind of capacity for change, such that, if you like, earlier stages of the universe have the wherewithal to develop into later stages of the universe. He has a very evolutionary theory. But unlike the Neoplatonists, he doesn't think this evolutionary process is unsupported. He thinks that God is active right the way through, sustaining this developmental process and the world of changing things.
He thought that the state existed to further the well-being of the individual in a well-ordered environment. Then, in 410 AD, the Visigoths sacked Rome. 2 years later, he began writing The City of God. Unlike Plato's Republic or Aristotle's Politics, this is not a treatise on the ideal earthly city. In Augustine's work, the City of God is contrasted with the City of Babylon.
Thank you.
It was Albertus who introduced Aquinas to the works of Aristotle. Like the Greek philosopher, Aquinas believed that truth could be arrived at by logic and reason. Aquinas followed Aristotle's theories about the movement of the spheres that bore the heavenly bodies. But Aquinas believed that angels were the causes of this movement.
The fundamental feature of angels for Aquinas is that they lack matter. The reason for this is that matter is that principle which allows something to be destroyed by some natural agent. And Aquinas thinks that angels are indestructible by any agent other than God. The lack of matter has a rather disconcerting consequence, which is that each angel is a different species. Michael, the archangel, is as different from Gabriel, the archangel, as a dog is from a cat, perhaps. The reason for this is that Aquinas thinks that material substances like you and me are distinguished from each other by effectively being different lumps of matter. Angels don't have matter, so they must be distinguished from each other in some other way. And the way in which Aquinas believes they are distinguished is by being different kinds of thing. But its lack of matter also means that it can't exist in the universe in the same way as material beings do. And Aquinas believes that for an angel to be present in the universe is just for an angel to be causing an effect somewhere in the universe. And that's all there is to it.
Aquinas taught that men, as political animals, needed the state to further the ends of its citizens. But human law was subordinate to both natural and divine law. The church existed to further men's union with God.
Although Aristotle was very useful for the medieval theologians, there were certain difficulties that were raised and that kept on cropping up really throughout the 13th century. Fundamentally, Aristotle's worldview is very naturalistic. There's not really a place in it for a creator God, for example. Aristotle thinks that the world is everlasting, it doesn't have a beginning, and his God is something rather different from the Christian's creator. Matters reached something of a crisis in the 1270s, culminating in 1277, with the condemnation of a large number of Aristotelian claims taken from really Christian writers through the 1260s and 1270s, including Thomas Aquinas, who was recently dead by then. The Archbishop of Paris took exception fundamentally to what theologians perceived to be the necessitarianism of Aristotelian thought, that is to say that everything happens as a matter of necessity, including not only the actions of creatures, but also the creative act of God. And this was felt to be inconsistent with Christianity in quite a big way.
Like Aquinas, Scotus set out proofs of the existence of God. He went to Paris, but was expelled by Philip the Fair in 1305. He returned later, and then moved on to Cologne, where he died in 1308.
Scotus's proof for the existence of God is not unrelated to the kinds of proof that you find in Aquinas. So, for example, Scotus thinks that you can formulate an argument for a first cause, and that you can formulate an argument for a final goal of all existence, and he also thinks that you can formulate an argument for a most perfect of all beings. He takes much more trouble than Aquinas to try to show that this is one and the same being, and that you shouldn't really call it God until you've managed to show it has got certain attributes. But Scotus thinks that the kinds of proof that we find in Aquinas aren't in themselves sufficiently rigorous. What he objects to is the fact that Aquinas' premises are contingent, that is to say, they're not premises that are logically necessary. But for a good Aristotelian argument, Scotus thinks you need premises that are logically necessary, such that they couldn't be false. So he replaces the first premise of the cosmological argument, for example, with the claim that it's possible